welcome everyone to Melbourne Community Church. Look, I want everyone to stand up because we just need to wake up. It's a little bit early, so stand up please. Go to someone not beside you, shake their left hand, and tell them that God sees something special in you. Isn't it just wonderful how God turns up? We've all turned up on a beautiful day. God, he declares himself in the sunshine and all things around us. And then we get a little bit of thunder to say, I've got the power too. So God's here with us. Look, let's just bow our heads with prayer before we start into our worship. Your Father in heaven, you do not pull any punches. You show us who you are, and you are so clear with your love for us. And Lord, today as we come to worship, we want to take time to remember Lyell and what he's taught us and the passion that he has for worship, and that we can do him justice and make him proud of what we've heard and worship you, Lord, in the way that that you love to see us, Lord. We just ask you to bless the speakers today, Lord, that the message that you have given us each, that the words that are important to you, they fall on the ears that they need to hear. Lord, we thank you so much. We love you in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. And, well, it's time to sing a song. So please, on your feet for our first song. First song is Praise to the Lord.
To the Lord, your mighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him for he is thy strength and salvation. Oh, he who hid now to his temple draw to the Lord, let all that is in me adore.
be seated. For the reading today, we've got a Psalm 8 translation by Deidre JVR. All of creation beckons me to worship you. The grandeur of the universe echoes your glory. More than spectacular is the work of your hands. Who can match your brilliance and authority? You set boundaries for the ocean. You raise majestic mountains to touch the sky. Sunrise and sunset happens on your watch. Holy, holy, the earth is filled with your glory. Who is humankind that you are mindful of us? The frail sons and daughters that you would entrust us rule over all you have made. Who are the peoples of the earth that we get to bear your image? Holy, holy, the earth is filled with your glory. Who am I that you even notice me? How can it be that my tears and dreams matter to you? Eternal God, beyond time and space, who am I that you lean in when I draw near? Wind and sea obey at your command, yet you invite me to follow you with a whisper. Holy God, you know my hidden sin, yet you offer me new mercies every morning. The earth is filled with your glory. Time for our next song.
This is my Father's word, and my listening ears. All nature sings and round me rings the music of the
in it as a beautiful creation that you've made. And Lord, just as today, we just want to take time to reflect on that. And we sort of pray as myself, Dan and Kai get up to speak, and Jeff, that we can teach and show just how much effort and how much love and how much dedication you have to your creation. In your name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Ooh.
truly, it is an honour to be able to speak in front of my classmates. Something you've been very excited about. And once a year, the finest watchmakers in all the world come together for the Watch World Awards. And they vie for the titles as Best Designer, Best Concept, the Most Complicated Watch, the Most Innovative, and Artistic Excellence. You know what? Some of these watches are worth upwards of $300,000. And some of them that have won these awards don't even have a price tag. So you can make an offer. And the most coveted title is Watch of the Year. And this year, the watch that won it is for a bargain price of $16,000. You see, it's not because of its price that it won. It won because it incorporates the latest technology. And that it has an emergency beacon that is capable of transmitting two different frequencies for 24 hours. So you find yourself in a spot of bother, you activate that, there's a good chance that you're going to get found. And they've already sold over 40,000 of these watches. So you can do the math later on if you want to figure out how rich someone just got over that. And they've actually saved 20 people. And one thing about this watch is that once it's activated and it goes for 24 hours, at the end of that 24 hours, the watch is over. It becomes inoperable. It's no good anymore. It's served its purpose. It's finished. So if you're found alive, the manufacturer guarantees that they will replace that watch free of charge. As long as it was a legitimate emergency. So I found myself thinking, what constitutes a legitimate emergency? You know, I wonder what the terms and conditions would be. And I thought, this opera is killing me. That's the one that came to mind. I don't think that was legitimate. And one that some of you might relate to is Hebrew with Ross Cole. Get me out of here. Look, the reason I'm talking about watches is, you know, they're incredible. They're just an example of just careful planning, process put together. You know, they represent just an ingenuity, and they're a created thing. And maybe that's why people have looked at watches and said that God is like the watchmaker. And these people, you know, they saw God as that he came down, like he made earth, he created it, he processed time, you know, he didn't miss out any details. He got that thing sorted out, then he set it in motion, and he walked away. That's how they look at it. But I tell you what, then I've got a message for those people. Because the Bible is a self-revelation of God. And God makes it clear that he is more than just a watchmaker.
Amen.
And God reveals on the first page of the Bible, Genesis 1, and lays the foundation that are vital for understanding what God is, what God is like, and he totally gives you the information to say if he's still here or not. In Genesis 1, I'm just going to talk about that first chapter in the Bible. God is pre-existent. The first words in the Bible, in the beginning God, came from nowhere. What was before him? God was there. Where did God come from? God simply is. God is powerful. The seven verses that begin with the same words, then God said. And everything God spoke, it happened. God is perfect. Everything God made was good. The light was good. The seas were good. The plants were good. Yeah, those plants are good. But God never makes mistakes. And God is profound. Every good thing that God created came from the overflow of his own beauty. And one thing that I love about this first chapter in the Bible is God is plural. In verse 26, it says, then God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. in Genesis 1:2, it talks about, it portrays the Holy Spirit as hovering over the waters. And I read that, and it seems to me that it seems like he's waiting to care for the created things. And Paul writes in Colossians 1:15, verse 17, he addresses this issue of Trinity. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rules or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and this is my favourite part, and in him all things hold together. See, this verse is just loaded with significant statements. Talking about Christ, that he is before all things. So when we talked about God declares in the first words in the Bible, in the beginning God, Christ was there with him. All things were created through Christ. And the other statement that I love, and that really turns that watchmaker theory on its head, is that in him all things hold together. And the Creator has not forgotten about creation. We witness a daily reminder of God's close and active love in nature with the sunrise and the sunset. Without fail, it happens. And it's just such an obvious thing. It was so clear to Paul that he couldn't have put it in any clearer way. So in Romans 1:19-20, since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them, for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. We are without excuse. How awesome is that? How wonderful is it that we are without excuse? God leaves us no room to not be aware that he is our creator. I think that's a wonderful thing. A thunderstorm, we heard a little one before. A raging sea. A snow-topped mountain, was an excellent picture of one before in the last song. And a sleeping baby. I was leaving with this last thought. If the creation is that glorious, how beautiful must the Creator be?
Wow.
So I want to thank you for listening to that. And I'd like you to welcome Dan. Let me speak next to you.
Dan. Hey guys, I just have to ask you yesterday if we had a bit of a problem with my throat, so I might just sound rusty or something. I'm actually going to be speaking about Sabbath. The rest of God.
So, the Sabbath. As Sabbath is its own doctrine by itself, I was specifically trying to focus on the first Sabbath, as revealed through creation. So if we look at the text in which it is first highlighted, it brings to light the original Sabbath. By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. So does God need rest? We wouldn't think so, would we? But it clearly says that he rested because of all the work he had done. Isn't that a bit strange? I thought so. So I did a bit of thinking about it, and I also found that he blessed it. He sanctified it. He made it holy. Why? If we go to Exodus, the Ten Commandments,
that's what
we will discover that it actually, in the Sabbath commandment, it is written that it's to remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. So in order for us to remember what God has sanctified, we must sanctify it ourselves, so to speak. It goes on to say, 6 days shall you labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day. In an oral culture, such as the Israelites of that time period, things that were of great importance were often repeatedly memorized so that the people could not forget it, so to speak. So when the Ten Commandments specifically say remember it, they were trying to emphasize the importance of remembering this particular day. Now for us, some people would just say, it's just another day. Why should we worship God on this particular day? How can we not? We have to keep it holy. It's a commandment. But how are we to keep it holy? Some versions of the Bible in this particular text say by keeping it holy, whereas others say to keep it holy. So, historically speaking, we're more likely to remember something if we can clearly differentiate it from something else. So, by working 6 days in the week and separating the Sabbath day as a day of rest and day of holiness, we're more likely to remember it. That's what the Israelites did. We are to remember it by keeping it holy in order to keep it holy. The seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In the King James Version of this particular text says, of the Lord your God. So, not exactly sure what the Hebrew is, I'm sure I'll know by the end of semester, but in this particular text context, the seventh day is the Sabbath to God and of God. So the Sabbath here is signified as reflecting God's nature somehow, and is also identified as the day of God. And it goes on to repeat creation, for in 6 days God made the heavens and the earth. It is reinforcing the creation story, showing the people, the readers, how important the story is to the writers of the book of Exodus. And all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. This idea of rest is clearly visible throughout the Old Testament. The idea that God rested and blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. God's blessing doesn't come lightly, according to the Old Testament, and he's blessed an entire day. He differentiated this day from the rest because he wanted us to remember it. So he gave us a model week, so to speak. 6 days of work and 1 day of rest. Now, of course, this makes sense because everyone needs rest. But in the feudal societies, there were no weekends. The only time they got off from work was when they went to church, so to speak. And that was a Sunday morning. And even then, most of them didn't get Sunday afternoons off. So if we follow the model week of God, we have an idea of what it should do. And I'd like to finish with a fun fact. In the Arab world, there is only 2 days with actual names, Friday and Sabbath. Sabbath means to rest or day of rest, or literally in Arabic means to hibernate or to not do anything. And Friday, the term just means day of gathering. So to this day, the Arabs and the Muslims recognize the importance of Sabbath, and yet most Christians do not. It's a shame, but yeah. Thanks, guys. And now we will hear from Jeff through our electronic recording. He'll be speaking on the image of God.
Well, hello, everybody. It's Jeff here, coming to you from the beautiful Yarra Valley. And I'm excited to be part of your worship program this morning. Just to talk to you for a few minutes about the image of God, part of our creation. When I sit down at the dining room table and I look at the meal before me, I consciously choose what food I will eat last. What taste I wish to be left with in my mouth to savour. In other words, I leave the best to last. I'd like to suggest to you this morning that God, in creating man and woman on day six, he left the best to last. A proposition clearly supported by his own words when he said, let us make man in our image. in our likeness. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. What a striking concept, to be made in God's image. But what does it really mean? Well, it's fair to say that a few minutes of my ahead of us are probably not going to provide a comprehensive answer that you deserve. And let's face it, it's a question that's been pondered and debated for centuries. I will, however, share just my own historic perspective on the question, but more importantly, the implications of what it means to be made in God's image. Now, growing up, I can clearly remember wondering what God looked like. I'm sure you were the same. Who is this being that we pray to? So a little girl was in her class, but the teacher gave students the assignment of drawing something from the Bible. Well, the teacher walked around from desk to desk, and she saw pictures of arcs and animals, and she gets to the little girl's desk, and she says to the little girl, she says, and what are you drawing? Oh, comes back and replied, I'm drawing a picture of God. Well, the teacher was a little bit taken back, and she said, but nobody knows what God looks like. Well, unperturbed, the little girl enthusiastically responded, oh, well, they will in a minute. Which to some degree reflected my experience. I grew up thinking that God was some sort of pristine, Patagonian almost, super version of humanity. And the consequence of the sin, well, that had reduced us to our somewhat average sub-6-foot state with bumps and lumps and lines and creases that worsened in appearance over our 70 years. And that's what I thought. I'm not here to debunk that or to knock that. And I apologize if you feel like I've just told you there's no Santa Claus. And it's an understandable position, because Moses in his autobiography declared that he spoke with God face to face, and God backed Moses up, Numbers 12:7. Have a look, Numbers 12:7, you've got your Bible there, Numbers 12:7. This is the Lord speaking, and he says, but this is not true of my servant Moses. He is a faithful man in all my house. With him I speak face to face, clearly not riddles. He sees the form of the Lord. So these brown hair, blonde hair, tan skin, dark skin, sunset cloud, lightning bolt, mist or rushing wind questions, these are good questions. And there's a certain irony in that the more we know of God, the more we want to see. My experience now, how I understand God to be, his image to be. The image of God, for me, is not a physical thing. You know, it may come in a physical package. And Tuesdays and Thursdays, well, they may be his look like a human day. But the image of God is his character. So to be made in his image, to be made in his character, to reflect his qualities, the fruits of his spirit, the love, the joy, the peace, the patience, the goodness, the faithfulness, the meekness, the self-control. These are the image of God that should capture our attention. You know, focus on anything else is, I would suggest, a distraction. Which leads me in closing to the implication of the question, what does it mean to be made in his image? You know, God made us to be like him. To love, to work, to serve, to worship, to find joy, to give pleasure. You know, originally in a perfect state, that's why he made us. To be like him, to be his character, to take his form. And in our lumped and bumped state, so to be made in his image, the implication is that we need to live in his image. And may that be our experience.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I'm honored to stand in front of every one of you. And today, you know, we have listened three of the short talk, and the last one is the image of God. So as we have heard that we are created in the image of God, but we are God. It's not only stopped there, but after He created us as His image, He entrusted us to look after the creation. That's very important. Why He created like His image? Because He not simply created us as His image, but He wants us to responsible something, so that He created in His image. He gave us a dominionship over all the creation. So today my topic would be stewardship of creations. I'm going to read the Bible key text for my topic, which can be found in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. So here, firstly, I like to define the definition. I like to define stewardship, the definition of the stewardship. So what exactly does that stewardship mean? So the official definition of that word stewardship is the conducting, supervising, or managing of something, especially the careful and responsible management of something entrusted to one's care. So which means when God gives a dominionship and assigned us and appointed us to look after this creation, He wants us to be conduct and supervise and managing all the creations according to His will, and He's entrusted us to look after all that, all the creations. So sometimes when we talk about this stewardship, we mainly refer to money and sort of thing. But when we look through the Bible, stewardship is mainly, we can find in the Genesis, which mainly talk about the look after the creations, not about the money and sort of thing. Unlike the rest of the creations of humanity is not recorded just a matter of fact. We humans are created with a unique purpose and responsibility. That is to actively care for the rest of God's creation. God's first words to human were about the relationship, but not about the relationship between humanity and God, but between humanity and creation. So when we look at the Genesis chapter 2 verse 28, we can see that be fruitful and multiplied and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. See, I have given you every plant and every tree. So here we see that the dominionship. But we are just to dominionship, but we don't have the right to manipulate. So that's very important thing. So here we were, as a human being, we were created not to be mere users or consumer of what God has put on the earth, but to be stewards of creation. So here we tend to think about stewardship as something that we do, often something that we are compelled to do. But the author of Genesis reminds us that stewardship is fundamentally part of who we are as God's people. We are to subdue and exercise dominion over the earth. So in original Hebrew language, it reveals that it must be understood in terms of caregiving and nurturing what God has given rather than exploitation. So this means that we are to be mindful of the ways that we use what God gifted us with. So here, we are created to partner with God, to make sure that God's creation and all of the creatures within it are well taken care of. So here, in John Wesley, once wrote that we are not at liberty to use what God has lodged in our hands as we please, but only God pleases, who alone is the possessor of heaven and earth, and the Lord of every creature. So here, we have no right to dispose anything we have, but according to God's will, and seeing as we are not proprietors of any of these things, nor is anything properly our own in the land of our pilgrimage. So, and then, very important point, one of the very important points is, I want to name some of the things that God has entrusted us as a steward. Some of these many things we wouldn't have thought of before, but I just want to give you some points here. The first point is, our soul, which I included our emotion, memories and our imaginations. And then the second is our bodies, including our energy, abilities, senses, and speech. And the third point, like I include the other category, including time, health, influence, and education. And the fourth point I put as the worldly possession, like including food, clothing, and homes, and all sort of thing. So all these are also like God entrusted us to look after carefully, not according to our will, but according to His will. So I just like to draw my conclusion here. So as we think about the stewardship, think also about the other things that God has put in our life and how they can be used to serve God most effectively. I hope that now is the best time that you have in your life. Whether you find yourself with a lot of money or a little, with a good help or a little, or a lot of extra time or a little, a lot of education or a little, know that God has gifted you. And what you do with those gifts matters to God. So as a stewards, we are not just simply representing our Lord, our Creator. We are not simply simulating a divine role, but we are carrying out the divine mandate. So stewardship is an employment, but not it's not a leisure. So God has given to each and every one of us a vocation and a calling to go about our Father's business, just as Jesus did. So we are meant to be the good stewards that God intended for us to be since in the beginning. So our role as the stewards are accountable to the Lord for our stewardship. That is why this is the uniqueness of human being, and this is the human uniqueness in creation. Among all the physical creation, only humans are morally accountable for their actions. Therefore, God will call us to account for what we have done for Him, for ourselves and over which we rule. We are stewards of the owner of the world and the Creator, to fill, rule, and care for creations. So we are here to serve and to preserve the creation, either for the better or for the worst, in the positive or negative direction. But in the end, we will be held responsible for everything in the day of judgment, when the book of life will be opened and our names will be held account to the lives we lived on earth during our lifetime. I pray that may God bless each and every one of us so that we will become a good stewards for our Creator. Thank you. God bless you all.
Amen.
Something incredibly special in each one of us. So I just want to ask everyone just to split into groups of three or four and just I encourage you all just to do a short prayer amongst yourselves and just about the message you've heard and about the current things that are going on. And, just a bit of prayer, please.
You everyone. Look, we've got one final song to finish off our program, so enjoy.
Yeah, definitely.
Thank you. How great thou art.